Hi, my name is Lorraine Watry, and welcome to my studio. I am a watercolor artist, and I've worked with watercolor for 26 years now, and I thought I would start a new series of videos where I go over different tips, tricks, and techniques for working with watercolor. And hopefully these short videos will help you in your journey, and if you have a question or a technique that you would like to see, please comment below, and I will try to accommodate that in a future video. Start this video with a close-up of the fabric that I will be painting, and I'm going to talk about a few aspects of it before I show you how I would paint it. So when you're painting fabric, it is about painting both the form shadows and the cast shadows. So cast shadows are the ones that are created, and I'm going to go ahead and point to one here, by the fabric blocking the light that is shining on it. And so you can see that there. You could see a cast shadow right down in here. This dark shadow is a cast shadow. And then you can also see cast shadows in the foreground here, right up in that area. And then form shadows are shadows that are created because the fabric is curving. So right there is a form shadow, and you can see how it's got a softer edge. And generally with form shadows, you're going to have softer edges. This is somewhat of a form shadow, but then also probably there's a little bit of a cast shadow there because this part of the fabric is blocking a little bit of light. So it can be a combination of the two in some cases. This right here is a form shadow, so you can see the softer edge right there, and then there's a little bit of a darker side right there where it turns away from the light. And the other thing to note with fabric is that if it has a pattern, depending on how the fabric is laid down, so this fabric I bunched up and I kind of gave it some variation. I didn't make it smooth. So then the pattern is going down and around, and that can help give you form to your fabric and help describe the fact that it's not laid down flat. If it were on a flat surface, then the pattern would all lay out nicely. And then you can see that same kind of thing down in here, where this line probably is the same one as this or this one right here. Maybe even, I think it's this one. And so it is offset. So when the pattern comes down this way, then it actually moves over and curls down here because a portion of the fabric is pushed up under in that area. Okay, so I'm going to clear this away. Oh, actually, one more thing. The fabric image that you're working with, whether it's got pattern or not, can show more or less form depending on how well it is lit. So if it is really lit like this, you'll see the different shadows and things, but you may not see them as readily as you would if there is more dramatic light. So I'm going to turn off the light right quick, and I will show you the difference between the two. Not turn off the light, but I'll turn off some of the lights around my table here, and then you'll see the more dramatic lighting. Okay, so I have turned off some of the light around my table, and now you can see some of those earlier shadows are even stronger. And one of the other things to note whenever you're doing a still life or something that is being lit by possibly multiple lights, you may have a variety of shadows happening. And in this case, we've got a lighter shadow right down in here, and then the darker shadow right under the fabric. And some of that is because there are actually two lights on. There's one in the background and then one up a little higher. So I could turn off the second light and even have a more dramatic effect. The one light source, and actually I can't say just one because I do have the curtains on my window open, but that window is a little farther back, so that light is adding a little bit of extra light to the subject, but it's not going to affect it as much as the light that was just on. And now you can see by turning off that light, I have a solid shadow here from the one light source, and everything is a little more dramatic and looks different than it did a little while ago. So I will pull everything away here and get the image out, and then I'll show you a little bit with paint how you might create the look of the fabric. All right, so I have my drawing on my paper, and I have a photograph of the towel, and I tend to work from photographs most of the time. Plus, it just is easier for the video process to look at the image rather than the actual towel. And one of the things that photographs can do is they basically flatten the image so that you're seeing the shapes and everything compared to a two-dimensional piece of paper rather than the forms that would be in a still life. So I think working from life is wonderful and all of that, but if you're either new to drawing or trying to figure out the shapes and patterns, sometimes it's easier to take the image and work from the image. So I am going to use sap green, and then I will also get out some new gamboge. I did not put any of the pattern on my paper for the painting because there's just a lot of pattern going on, and I want it to be more about the shapes and values rather than the pattern for this video. And so I pulled out sap green, and then I'm going to get some new gamboge. And the first process for this towel for me is just to get that green color on everywhere. And I can paint parts of it lighter, parts of it darker if I want, but I'm going to look at sort of the lightest value that I'm seeing and paint on that color everywhere. Then I will dry it and I'll be right back. So let's do the green first. And it is sort of a yellow green, so I pulled out the new gamboge to adjust my sap green and make it more of a olivey yellow green. And it probably won't match exactly, but just as long as I get close, I am happy. So I have the paint wet enough that I can get it on the paper. I'm just going to start at the top edge and basically paint the whole towel with that color. And I want to make sure that I have enough pigment, not enough pigment, enough water in the pigment so that as I'm working down the shapes, I can get the color on without creating an edge that will give me lines. And if you have too dry of paint, you will end up a lot of the time creating lines or texture in the paint you're applying because it's not quite wet enough to keep that from happening. All right, so I'm going around that little piece that's sticking out. And there may be something kind of in the shadow right there that's part of the towel, but because I can't see that, I'm not going to worry about putting color in there. And I'm just finishing up. And I am getting a little too dry down here at the bottom because you can see how it's kind of skipping over the paper there. So I should have mixed up just a little more color, but as long as I come back quickly, I can get the paint on everywhere. It's usually with watercolor, if you're moving a little too slow, that you end up possibly having some issues with the paint you're putting on. And so I tend to work with a little bit of speed. So now I have color on the whole towel. And I will dry this, and I will come back and show you the next step. So now that the base coat is dry, I can start adding the shadows and the form shadows. So the cast shadows and the form shadows. And that is what's going to make the cloth look realistic and that it has folds. So I am going to start by using the sap green just as a layer over the previous color that I put down. And so I'm pulling sap green out again a little more, and I will get a little more new gamboge out, and I want to make sure that it's a little darker, so just make sure that I have enough pigment on my brush. And pull the new gamboge, and this is a warmer yellow. And I won't have a lot on my brush, so I won't need all that. And you can see that when I'm mixing colors, I don't always mix the whole thing together. I will sometimes just take a little bit and mix it and get the value or the colors that I want. Now, when you start this, because form shadows have a soft edge, I need to have either a second brush, or before I would use the brush I'm using, I would clean it and then use clear water as my next step. So I will work on the form shadows next, because they are lighter than, in general, than the cast shadows. And I tend to work light to dark. And so I'm going to place water away from where I want that soft edge to be, and probably a little bit down in here as well, and a little bit right in here. And then I will take the paint that I got ready, and I will start at the bottom edge of where that shadow that I'm going to do is sitting, because that edge is a little hard edge down there because of how the towel is laying. And then as it hits the water, as I come up, as it hits the water, it starts to soften right in there. And I'm going to bring it up just a little higher because I want it to move a little farther up. And the other thing is, if my brush has a lot of water and paint in it, I can always dry the back edge just a little bit. Don't take the color off, but by drying that back edge, that allows me to control how much water is in the brush. Now right here, there is a little bit of a hard edge that I'm seeing, so I'm going to leave that as a hard edge, and then I'll come down into here. I need to lift some color because I just put some color where I don't want it. And I'm going to go into a little more green, and then right in here there's a variation where there's some hard and soft edges, so I want to catch the water that I placed, and then also leave this edge a little harder right there. So now I'm starting already to see a little more form happening. And the reason that you place the clear water as far away as I did is because, depending on the paint you're using and how wet it is, if you place the water just kind of right here, sometimes that color that you paint on can move up and hit the edge of that water, and then it forms a new hard edge. So to avoid that, I place the water a ways away. Now right here, there is some hard edge happening, and then it does soften a little bit, and I actually should not have painted right in there. There's a lighter value. So I'm going to go, and while it's still damp, the paint that I put on, I can go and lift this back just a little bit and adjust that edge so that this looks like it's highlighted. And I do have to sometimes keep going back here and there because it can want to wander, the wet paint can want to go back into that shape. So just using a brush to lift, and my brush is just barely damp. And then as I come around right in here, actually this is forming a edge that I don't want. So I'm going to use some clear water away from where I am putting that, or where I put that color. And then I will come in and touch next to that edge so that it has room to move. And I put the water way out over here, so if some of that paint continued to move, it wouldn't create a hard edge. And then I'm just going to probably leave this edge for now, and later, after it's dry, I could come back and adjust that edge if I want to. So because this is wet, I can't do anything right in there, and I'll go to this edge right now. And I'm going to use, there's actually some water sitting there from earlier, so I'll get close to that water, and I am not going to touch into that edge because I don't want to possibly have an issue with a bloom happening. And I'm going to come around this shape. So again, this is just clear water. And then I'll go back into my paint over here and a little bit more of the new gamboge. Up on this corner, there's just a little bit more color right in there. And I'm drying it so it doesn't move too far. And then I'm going to come around and a little more paint. And I can see the soft edge right in through here, and then this is the edge of the towel where it's folded over on the left side right here. And it creates a little bit of a concave area that is a little more in shadow. And this has just a little bit of a hard edge right there. I don't know if that will last because of how where I applied the water, but that's okay. And then I'm going to come down and touch the water that I applied down here. So all of this is soft edged. I am getting a little bit of color that's moving. Sap green tends to want to push into wet areas a little more than some colors, and so I'm just going to use a damp brush and soften that so that it's not got a hard edge over here forming. Same thing up here. Now, if your paint is starting to dry too much, and if I have too much moisture on my brush and went back to do that, I could cause a bloom to happen. Or I could lift a little too much. So sometimes it's better just at that point just to pause and let it dry, and then you come back and adjust those edges. And then this, it did push into this area a little bit too much as well. So I'm just going to use the clear water and soften right there. Okay, so I am going to finish doing the soft-edged form shadows for this, and then I'll dry it and I'll come back and show you some cast shadows. Placed the form shadows pretty much everywhere around the piece of material, and I am going to start placing some cast shadows. The cast shadows are going to be cooler, and I am using ultramarine deep with, I will use it with the sap green to give me a blue-green color. I might even put a little bit of the new gamboge in there as well. And they will start help giving or start giving me the value definition or change, so that you'll see the light lights and the dark darks, and that will help give the fabric even more form. Now, if you were doing this on white fabric, then you might be using grays, blues, purples. There might be bounce back light onto the fabric that could give it some warm tones, even in the yellows and peaches and things like that, for the different form and cast shadows. So you have to really kind of look at your image and see what you're viewing, and depends on the fabric whether or not you would be ready to put these in at this stage. You may have more that you need to do layer wise. I tend to put lots of layers on before I would go into the shadows, and generally the shadows are going to repeat the same colors that are beneath them, and so I always place the shadow colors on top of the colors that are part of the object, whether it's cloth or some other material. Now, watercolor will dry 20 to 30% lighter, and some of these edges, like right in here, feel just a little softer than the way I applied it. If your paint is really wet, like it is right down in here, I would wait to do that until you notice that a lot of the shine is gone off of the paper. And right in here, there's a little bit of a softer edge. It kind of can depend on also how close in you are on the fabric, because some fabric will have a little bit of a weave or a bumpy surface to it, and so that can make some of the shadows feel a little softer edged as well. And then there is a darker shadow right in here. And like I said, I am making this go a little faster for this video than I might do it in my on my regular painting. I would maybe take a little more time and put some of these shadows in after I had done a little more layering, or I had added the pattern. If there's a pattern on the fabric, I would put the shadows on last after doing the pattern, so that you have the colors of the pattern underneath the shadow. And I do see a little bit of a rough edge there, and that's from the surface of the fabric, so I'm just going to soften that just a little bit. So this edge is definitely a harder edge, and so just putting in the shadow right in there can start to give it a little more form. There is more some darker value in this area, so I'm going to go into some of the greens. I did place some clear water on that area before I went and got my color, and I am going basically following the edge of where this part of the fabric separates from that part. I'm just giving it a little more. Okay, and then there's a shadow right in here. And some of them are very defined edges, and others, like I said, are a little soft edged. So you kind of have to really pay attention to what you're seeing. All right, and then there's a dark shadow. Actually, I'm going to do the light shadow first. There is a lighter version of the shadow that goes from up in here, down, maybe right about in there. And then it gets a little darker right in the middle. I went back and got a little more of the ultramarine deep, in that mix. And then as it comes down, it will get even darker right down in here, but I'll have to go get more paint on the brush. And then right along this edge, there's some of that shadow. And it does have a softer edge right in there. So I'm going to go get some more ultramarine deep. A touch of the sap green in it. Don't necessarily want it too blue. Oh, a little more. I had a little too much moisture on my brush, so I wasn't seeing the pigment the way I wanted to. Okay. And I could put a little more right in there. Right, and then while this edge is still wet, I'm going to go get some clear water and come up and put the clear water on away from the edge. Get just a little more, and then touch where that edge is and let some of this edge fade upward into the paint. Or I mean into the clear water. And I actually think because the sap green wants to move more sometimes than other pigments, I'm going to put the clear water up even higher. Now, if you had an edge like that and you didn't feel like you could get it to go where you want it to by doing it this method, you could let that dry completely and then come back and soften the edge with some water. So this is almost dry here, and I can take my brush with a little bit of water on it and just going back and forth over that edge, I can soften that edge just a little bit. And this edge is a little rough looking, so I'm going to straighten it up just a touch with the clear water. Now I am going to dry this, and then I can do the last few shadows that I will do, and hopefully you will have enough information then to be able to go try your own fabric. So I have a few more places that I want to add some color. The edge right here, I'm actually going to place some water first up in here. And I did do this as a form shadow earlier, but it is darker right along this edge, and then a little bit at the upper edge. And I knew I would probably have to go back into it. I did add some of the ultramarine deep blue to, and that is a Holbein pigment, to my sap green. And then as I'm coming down, I'm actually lightening the value of that paint just a touch with some water on my brush so that it will be a little lighter than the shadow that's below it. And I'm going back now. I feel like I need just a little bit more color kind of up in this corner. All right. And I will let that dry and blend in just a little bit. So this upper edge, I want to have just a little bit of a soft feel to it. Okay, and then over here I need some shadow, and I'm going to place the lighter shadows. Let's see where I want it. So there is a shadow here. And actually it comes down into this area, and it's a little bluer at this bottom edge. And then I need that to dry, and then I can put this shadow in. So I will dry that right quick. Oh, actually, before I do that, in shadows, even in your darker shadows, if you're looking at your object, or you can, if you have it sitting right in front of you, there are places that are darker in value in order to make everything separate. I have to go back and add a little more to some of these shadows to really get it to the right value. There we go. And there might be just a little bit more around that edge. And I'm going to pull that out. on the table itself, there are shadows. And in order to put those in, I will use a little bit of the ultramarine blue, and probably for this, they do look a little gray-green maybe. So I'm going to use my burnt sienna and the ultramarine deep. A little more. And maybe just a tiny touch of the sap green in that mix. So there is actually, it's even darker in here. There is a really dark shadow right up in there where the cloth is pretty much blocking the light. And then it comes down. I need more burnt sienna. And probably this would have to go even darker than it is right now, but I'll just put it in as I've got it going. Oops. A touch there. And then depending on your shadow, as it comes out from the object, it might have a little bit of change of color, or it might be a little lighter. Generally, the darkest part of the shadow is going to be right up under the object, and that's called the zenith of the shadow. And then right down here, there is also a shadow on the table. And this kind of thing, making sure you have shadows for your surface, if you can see that, can really help give the object some dimension, because it's making it feel like it's resting on something. And all right, so then I'm going to dry this, and I'll come back and put the last few shadows on, and then I will be done for this video. Right here where this darker shadow is, right now it kind of looks like it's a flat, very sharp angle, and that is because I don't have a form shadow there. So if I bring some clear water up in here and then some of the sap green with the new gamboge that I used earlier and paint that right up to that edge, and then let it fade just a touch dark. I want to go just a little lighter, so I'm going to put a little water on my brush and soften that out. And now that edge will start to have the feeling that it's a little more rounded and that there's a little less of a sharp edge right there on the fabric. And then I'm just softening that edge a little bit with clear water so that it doesn't move up too far. Okay, so now I'm going to go over here to this shadow, and I'm using the ultramarine deep again with the sap green, and this is another very dark passage or dark shadow right in here. It's got hard edges, and so I'm using the ultramarine pretty strongly in here. And then as I come over right in here, there's a hard edge that helps describe this line right there, and this one actually. And then right here there's a dark shadow that comes down and gets just slightly slightly wider as it's going down. Now if you had done something like this on your painting, it's best just to leave it and then come back later and pick it up. So sometimes with watercolor, if you try to mess with that right now, what it can actually do is make that shape possibly spread out and make it worse. So I'm just going to leave it alone, and then I can come pick it up in a few seconds. All right, so I noticed there's a little darker area up in here. And some right in there. And then I'm going to go back into this shadow where it's darker and use more of the ultramarine and burnt sienna and really come in there and darken that. May need more burnt sienna on my brush. I'm making almost a black with those two colors. And it comes out right about in here. All right, so I hope this video was helpful and gave you an idea of a process to go about for creating the look of fabric. And I will post this image at the end of the video. So if you would like to pause the camera and look at it a little closer, you certainly can. And like I said, if I were doing this for an actual painting, I would have gone a little slower with the whole process, but I wanted you to get a basic idea of the way that you work with form and cast shadows to make fabric look both soft and hard, depending on what the shadows are doing. And if you have a tip or trick with watercolor that you would like to see, please comment below and I will add that to the list of future videos. And I hope you have a good day. Thanks. Bye.